We have been making a ton of progress lately, and I want to keep that up. So today we are going to focus on a job that's going to take a long time to get done, and that's building a one-off custom carbon fiber hood. We got to get that iron in the fire. I also want to focus on getting jobs done that are critical towards getting this thing going, or in this case, stopping. I want to finalize our braking system and cross all of it off the list. And last but not least, we need to build and design a catch can system for our engine. So let's dive into this episode, which is brought to you guys by Autodesk Fusion 360. We're starting this episode out by rewinding to more than a year ago when we first installed our engine into the engine bay of the Ferrari. With just the intake manifold, the exhaust manifold, and the turbo in place, the bay was borderline empty. At the time, it was obvious where some components would go, such as the dry sump tank being located in the cavity directly behind the driver of the car. On the other hand, we took a guess for certain components, like the oil catch can. We mounted it in a logical place, directly next to the oil tank, because the two need to be connected. It stayed in that position for a long time, through the construction of the intercooler, but once I decided to not run an oil cooler, I rearranged our components, and the part has sat on the shelf ever since. But now we're back to it, because this catch can is an essential part of our dry sump system. As our dry sump pump extracts oil and blow-by gases from the crankcase, those gases need a place to go, and this is where they'll end up. Inevitably, oil will join those gases too, so we need a place to collect it. To mount the catch can, I'm just going to bend the factory stainless steel mount that it came with. As far as where to mount it, I've got a weird solution, but I can justify it, so hear me out. John Britton of Britton Motorcycles suggested that the parts on his bikes should always serve more than one purpose, that any part serving just a single purpose was excess weight. I'd like to embrace this mindset, so instead of building some steel welded mount off of the body of the car, we're gonna hang this thing off of our wing upright. Now, aside from weight, there is another major benefit to mounting it here that I'm gonna touch upon here in a moment, but before we actually mount the tank, let's swap out the filter element. Vibrant Performance offers this filter upgrade, which is a drop-in unit that is screened and baffled. On top of that, it's also a sealed unit, which means it'll do a better job of containing oil in the tank while letting those blow-by gases out. The way they accomplish sealing this thing up really well is through a bolt-in top plate that actually has O-rings inside of it. The included specialty AN fittings seal on those inner O-rings as well as the normal ORB O-rings further up. With the filter kit installed, we can install the catch can to our already mounted bracket on our wing upright. An O-ring on each side of this mount seals this whole unit up tight. I've got one port blocked off because we simply don't need it, and I've got the custom fitting installed in the other side. And now we need to plumb this thing into place. I want the hose to chase around the perimeter of the engine bay and to keep a relatively low profile. It's going to take a lot of hose to pull off, and this stuff isn't cheap, so it's smart to pre-route the hose and make sure that we get the length just right. So in the comments of one of my recent videos, a commenter pointed out that I don't line up the flats on my AN fittings. That doesn't actually do anything. He just said it's a small detail that I could do that would really take the build to the next level, and he's kind of deducting points because I'm not that detail-oriented and the devil's in the details. You get it. So I figured we'll set this one up just for that guy. We'll get the wrench on there. And now it's perfect. It's all lined up. And now it's not anymore. We've got the line connected from our catch can to the vent port of our dry sump tank so that the whole system functions properly. Now, any excess gases and oil that escapes will head all the way over to the back of the car, which brings us to that other added benefit. Ideally, this thing won't ever overflow, but if it does, now it'll drain out the back of the car instead of being mounted somewhere where it could spray the exhaust manifold and start a fire. There's no ideal place to mount this, but I think this is about as good as we're gonna get. Now our catch can slash dry sump system has one other component we need to install, and it's this. It is a vacuum regulator. I'm probably not gonna do a very good job of explaining how this works, so feel free to skip ahead. But Essentially, the crankcase of our engine is under vacuum because there's a dry sump pump attached to the bottom of it. It's providing negative pressure inside the engine to pull all of the air and oil out of it. It separates them and sends them back to our dry sump tank. This is gonna help us control the amount of vacuum inside the crankcase. It's an important component. We need this so the whole system functions properly. Nevertheless, we gotta install this on our valve cover, which is a little bit tricky. This thing comes with a -12 male ORB fitting on the bottom of it. They're nice enough to include an aluminum weld-on bung so you can attach this to your valve cover, but I don't really want to go welding on our nice, pretty valve cover. The four-piston cover does have four -10 ports on it, but two are blocked by our intercooler mount tube, and two are blocked by the fuel rail. Thankfully, they also included a -8 port on the end of the valve cover, so we're going to use this for the time being. I won't say that it's going to be elegant, but we're going to weld up a fitting that'll allow us to mount this vacuum regulator to this -8 port. I might change my valve cover later down the road, and this solution will work a bit better for that scenario. I was really happy with how the welds came out on this little guy, and with an O-ring in place, it's now ready to seal up on the valve cover and to accept the regulator. Clearance to the water neck is a bit tight, but as said, that'll change in the future with a valve cover change. I'll also probably redo this mount entirely just to come up with something more elegant, but in the name of getting this thing done, we can cross this off the list. It can run this way, and it can be tuned, and that's what counts at this point. Now let's revisit those splitter mounts that I designed a few episodes ago. Functionally, I think the design's gonna work really well, but once we went to go install them on the car, we ran into a pretty big issue. By virtue of using a paper template, I didn't get my measurements quite right, and our bracket didn't fit. What I should have done from the get-go was to use a protractor and get an accurate measurement, but I took a shortcut and paid for it. With good dimensions in hand, though, this is a really simple fix. We've still got all of our files in Fusion 360, so we can just hop over and modify the sketch we made this part with, add some material to the top of it, and now we've got something that should fit without any issues at all. This is the benefit of CAD design parts. It's really simple to go back, make changes, and just have them recut. I may play with the design a bit, but overall, I think this will get us home. But on the topic of Fusion 360, that brings us to the sponsor of today's episode.
If you're familiar with this channel, I'm hopeful that you've realized I have never done an ad integration before, and that's because it's something I refuse to do unless it's a product I actually believe in, and better yet, actually use, which is why I'm excited to say this episode is brought to you guys by Autodesk's Fusion 360.
I have eagerly pushed for the use of Fusion 360 in nearly every project on this channel. I've created tutorials around the software, I showcase my use of it, and I sing its praises because it is truly a powerhouse. It brings the design and manufacture side of the equation into a single piece of software that is easy to use. It offers control for CNC milling, additive manufacturing like 3D printing, and every aspect of design beginning to end. If that sounds complicated, it's not. With no formal training whatsoever, earlier this year, I designed a replacement chassis for our Model A, had everything laser cut, and then we built it on the workbench. The result was incredible, professional-looking parts I would have been incapable of making otherwise. But even on the small-scale projects, like tiny brackets and tabs, I find myself returning to Fusion 360 to aid in every build I undertake. And now, I get to share a free trial of Fusion 360 with you guys using the link in the description or the QR code on screen. It's an invaluable tool I'm confident you'll love, and you'll wonder how you ever got by without it. Now let's turn our attention to the brakes. A few episodes back, we got partway through hardlining the brake system of the car. In that episode, I talked about the tools that I used and the processes to make these hard lines, but I left the rear of the car unfinished, and in the time since, we've talked a little bit about why you might not want hard lines on your build. We'll touch upon that a little bit later in the episode, but for now, let's get this job finished. We left off with the rear brake lines unterminated, just sticking straight out at the back of the chassis. I made a series of marks to identify where I want to add bends to this line so that they'll terminate in the proper place. I walked you guys through the process of how to do all of this in the last brake line episode, so I'll spare you this time around. Instead, let's turn our attention to something new. I've got these little billet aluminum hard line mounts.
On top of being surprisingly cheap, these things are going to do a great job of clamping the hard line and holding it into place. It'll reduce any vibration that these things might experience and keep them from cracking over long-term use. They're also keyed and countersunk, so the finished product should look quite nice. For installation, I decided to drill and tap the chassis itself, as opposed to adding tabs and getting out the welder. I did power tap these holes though, and it was my first time doing so ever. I've always had fears of pulling the threads out of the hole, but this worked really well and it's something I'm going to employ more in the future. When snugged down, these clamps support the line as opposed to clamp down onto it, which means I positioned these clamps in multiple planes to ensure the line couldn't slide fore and aft. The lines themselves terminate above the frame rail, and then the soft lines continue out to the calipers, but that of course brings us to a new part, dry brakes. In the last brake line episode, I had soft lines made that will run from our hard lines out to the calipers. I took a lot of care to make sure that all four lines, one at each corner of the car, were the same length to make replaceability a lot easier. Well, I took these lines back to the hydraulic shop and had them modified. I had each one cut in the same position, all in the name of maintaining that same serviceability, but now we can add these. This is a dry brake fitting, and its purpose is so that you can disconnect the caliper from the car without introducing air into the system. This means that if I remove the calipers for any reason, I won't have to rebleed the entire brake system. It's a huge quality of life improvement, but let me be clear, these are not cheap fittings, so they're pretty hard to justify, but we're in this far, so why not? With the brake lines modified and the dry brake fittings inserted into them, I got all four soft lines hooked up at each corner of the car. I still need to add some sort of tab in order to secure the brake line to the control arm, but honestly, that can happen later down the line, and we can use zip ties in the interim. But with that, that's a few things we can cross off the list. That's hard lines, soft lines, and dry brake fittings installed.
Now we're pretty far into this, but some of you guys are definitely wondering about that note I made a few episodes ago where I said I was going to scrap all of the stainless lines and go to soft lines on the car for safety reasons. Well, the long and the short of it is this. I talked to a friend that is an aerospace hydraulic engineer. You could say this is his forte. He assured me everything that I've got here is set up exactly as it should be. He eased a lot of my concerns about stainless steel lines getting brittle, cracking. If they can use stainless steel lines on jets and if they can use them on trophy trucks, they're gonna be fine here. This is gonna see less abuse and less forces than either of those for sure. On top of that, a lot of you guys were concerned about single 37 degree flares on these lines. I did buy a tool. Let me show you what we're gonna do.
This might look like a bin of random fittings, but believe it or not, it is indeed a specialty tool. What we have here is a set of AN plugs, matching pairs for each size from -3 up to 16, but in one of the plugs is a Schrader valve so that you can pressurize whatever line you decide to plug. This is a very simple pressure test kit. Now let me be clear, I know shop air is nowhere close to the same pressures as brake lines, but we can still pressure test those hard lines as well as every other hose on the car and give ourselves a huge boost in confidence that they'll hold up and do their job. It's not perfect, but this tool will definitely give me some added peace of mind. Next on the list for the brakes is a fix I'm astounded no one has called me out on. I wouldn't say that it's obvious, but you commenters can be quite particular, and I hate to admit it, but for ages now, my rear brake rotors have been on backwards. This wouldn't keep us from driving nor stopping, but we do need to get them swapped from side to side. And as a tip for how to tell if your brake rotors are facing the wrong direction, even if you don't know the pattern, just stick a pencil in the top. It should always point towards the back of the car. If it doesn't, you've got it set up incorrectly. Now I'll be honest in saying that flipping my brake rotors wasn't on my list, but I'll take the victories where I can get them, so let's cross that off while we're talking about it, okay? Now let's get those brake pads installed. With the guidance of AP and Essex Parts, I went with Ferrotto's DS312 compound. It's great on track, but it still has some streetability to it, and as said over and over again, I really want to maintain some of that. Pad installation couldn't really be any easier. A single retaining bolt is removed, and then the pads drop right into the top of the caliper, as with most race brake applications. I am using AP Racing's brake pad tensioning kit for the sole purpose of reducing pad noise inside of the caliper. These don't really have a benefit outside of streetability, but again, I figured why not? It's worth the tiny bit of weight penalty. Installation up front is exactly the same, so I'll spare you the walkthrough, and we'll go on and cross some more stuff off of the list. We've got our pads officially installed, as well as all the pad accessories, which means at this point, the braking system is complete. All right, so the brake lines are done, the brake rotors are on in the correct direction, and the pads are in. At this point, the brake system is finished. We can call it complete. We could add fluid to it at this point, but I'm not going to, because that will only make it a bigger pain in the butt here in hopefully a week or two when I pull the entire engine and all of the suspension back off the car so that I can get the chassis ready to paint it. That's really important to me. I wanna get that done. And I don't wanna deal with brake fluid going everywhere because I'm not gonna try to stop the car between then and now anyway. It's wasted effort. So we're not gonna put brake fluid in the car right now, but we could. So check mark, another thing done. Brakes are good. Let's talk about the hood. The hood has been a bit of an ongoing project, and if you haven't seen the previous hood-based episodes, the mission is to add a heat extractor to the middle of it. This is only one part of a massive revision to the car's cooling system, but it's an important part of it. We need to get air through the front of the car and then out of the hood. So I built this sheet metal aluminum duct in the middle of it. The only problem is, this was my first ever attempt at working with sheet aluminum and my first time welding it. I can say that I'm happy with the outcome, and in fact, I'm proud of it, but the only problem is it's not really up to my own standards. Those can be mutually exclusive. So the new plan is to call in for a bit of help. Now, I'm hoping he doesn't mind that I'm borrowing video from his channel, which you should definitely check out, but I'm turning to my friend Paul of Son of Cobra Motorsports for help building a carbon fiber hood. Now, if you've never heard of Son of Cobra or seen Paul's work, that's unfortunate because his work speaks for itself, but I'll do my best to speak for it in this case. Paul is an absolute master of his craft, and that craft is composite work. The O2s you're seeing in this clip is a project he's taken on for the last number of years in an effort to build a nearly all-carbon O2. The doors, the fenders, the hood, the trunk, the roof, pretty much every aspect of this car is made of carbon by Paul himself, and the result is absolutely incredible. You'll see more of this car in this channel in the future if he gives me the opportunity to do so, but even just these few clips should speak volumes. Paul's gonna do some body work and then build a mold of my hood and then build it from carbon. So I'll keep you guys in the loop here in about a week when we take the hood over to his shop and drop it off. So I think that's pretty good progress for an episode. There's really only one thing I wanted to fit into this one that I ran out of time to do, and that's plumb the coolant for the turbo. I've got all of the pieces to do it, so we're gonna do that in the next episode. And then from there, I've gotta decide what comes next. I'm thinking about diving in and tackling the biggest project I've got left. I'm dreading it. I think maybe it's smart to just peel the Band-Aid off. I've gotta pull everything out of the engine bay, everything we've put into this car, all the suspension off. We've got to do a bunch of finish welding, we've got to prep, and we've got to paint the engine bay. It's a disaster. You guys have seen all the clips. It's covered in rust. It looks terrible. We've got to get this sorted out. I'm not looking forward to it. It'll probably take me longer than a week, but like I said, I think maybe it's just time to rip that Band-Aid off and get it done. But we'll see. I got to see what comes next, where the flow takes me. I've got that checklist, and I'm feeling good just checking stuff off over and over again. I gotta say thank you guys again for following along, for watching this series. I'm stoked you guys are loving the progress. I'm having a blast. Don't forget, click the link in the description. Try out that 30-day free trial of Autodesk Fusion 360. It is the best tool I have in the arsenal. I would not be suggesting it if I didn't love it. That's why it's in every episode. It is an absolute powerhouse. Check it out, hit that link, and I'll catch you guys next week. Thanks as always for the support.